During the years leading up to and during the Revolution, the founder of the Academy, John Adams, traveled frequently in service to the Republic. His wife, Abigail, tended to the household and farm back in Massachusetts. Their letters are an extraordinary chronicle of the day. Two distinguished new fellows of the Academy have agreed to read a selection of these letters. One is renowned for his sensitive and moving performances in film, television, and on the stage for nearly half a century. The other is one of the preeminent contemporary interpreters of traditional American music. It is my great pleasure to introduce two new fellows, James Earl Jones and Emmylou Harris.
Yesterday, the greatest question was decided, which ever was debated in America, and a greater perhaps never was or will be decided among men. A resolution was passed without one dissenting colony that these united colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states. And as such, they have, and of right ought to have, full power to make war, conclude peace, establish commerce, and to do all the other acts and things which other states may rightfully do. You will see in a few days a declaration setting forth the causes which have impelled us to this mighty revolution and the reasons which will justify it in the sight of man, of God and man. A plan of confederation will be taken up in a few days.
Sunday, July 14th, 1776, Braintree, Massachusetts. Though your letters never fail to give me pleasure, be the subject what it will, yet it was greatly heightened by the prospect of the future happiness and glory of our country. Nor am I a little gratified when I reflect that a person so nearly connected with me has had the honor of being a principal actor in laying a foundation for its future greatness. May the foundation of our new Constitution be justice, truth, and righteousness. Like the wise man's house, may it be founded upon those rocks, and then neither storms or tempests will overthrow it.
Philadelphia, August 4, 1776. If ever I get through this scene of politics and war, I will spend the remainder of my days in endeavoring to instruct my countrymen in the art of making the most of their abilities and virtues, an art which they have hitherto too much neglected. A philosophical society shall be established in Boston, if I have wit and address enough to accomplish it some time or another. My countrymen want art and address. They want knowledge of the world. They want the exterior and superficial accomplishments of gentlemen, upon which the world has foolishly set so high a value. In solid abilities and real virtues, they vastly excel in general any people upon this continent. Our New England people are awkward and bashful, yet they are pert, ostentatious, and vain, a mixture which excites ridicule and gives disgust. They have not the faculty of showing themselves to the best advantage, nor the art of concealing this faculty, an art and faculty, which some people possess in the highest degree. Our deficiencies in these respects are owing wholly to the little intercourse we have had with strangers and to our inexperience in the world. These imperfections must be remedied. For New England must produce the heroes, the statesmen, the philosophers, or America will make no great figure for some time.
Braintree, August 14th, 1776. You remark upon the deficiency of education in your countrymen. It never, I believe, was in a worse state, at least for many years. The college is not in the state one could wish. The scholars complain that their professor in philosophy is taken up by public business to their great detriment. In this town, I never saw so great a neglect of education. The poorer sort of children are wholly neglected and left to range the streets without schools, without business, given up to all evil. If you complain of neglect of education in sons, what shall I say with regard to daughters who every day experience the want of it? With regard to the education of my own children, I find myself soon out of my depth and destitute and deficient in every part of education. I most sincerely wish that some more liberal plan might be laid and executed for the benefit of the rising generation, and that our new constitution may be distinguished for learning and virtue. If we mean to have heroes, statesmen, and philosophers, we should have learned women. The world perhaps would laugh at me and accuse me of vanity, but you, I know, have a mind too enlarged and liberal to disregard the sentiment. If much depends, as is allowed, upon the early education of youth, and the first principles which are instilled take the deepest root, great benefit must arise from literary accomplishments in women. Adieu, ever yours, Portia.
Paris, 12 May, 1780. My dear Portia, I could fill volumes with descriptions of temples and palaces, paintings, sculptures, tapestry, porcelain, etc., if I could have time. But I could not do this without neglecting my duty. The science of government, it is my duty to study. More than all other sciences, the art of legislation and administration and negotiation ought to take place, indeed, to exclude, in a manner, all other arts. I must study politics and war, that my sons may have liberty to study mathematics and philosophy. My sons ought to study mathematics and philosophy, geography, natural history, naval architecture, navigation, commerce, and agriculture, in order to give their children a right to study painting, poetry, music, architecture, statuary, tapestry, and porcelain. Adieu.